You're watching BBC Two, dedicating our Saturday night to BBC Radio One.
Good evening, this is Johnny Walker welcoming you to 3 hours on BBC Two, celebrating 30 years of Radio One. In a moment, the Radio One story, a warts and all rockumentary about Britain's premier pop station. Then get the Kleenex ready, as Simon Bates presents the first of three celebrity editions of Our Tune. At 10, whatever happened to the one-hit wonders?
What's the matter, you? Hey!
They top the charts, then vanish without trace. We get a little crazy with Chris Evans on the Radio 1 Roadshow before linking up with Radio 1 as Tim Westwood presents tonight's rap show.
See how we get down in the 9-7 on Radio 1.
And to finish, there's music from Ronnie Size and Represent.
Live.
So that's our lineup. Right now, here's the first track on our album of delights.
Greetings, pop pickers.
30 years young.
Oh, yeah!
I was out on the left wing, I like to think.
Too much TV rots the brain, unlike radio, which, of course, enriches the cultural life of the nation.
He's a complete nutter.
30 years young.
We lost none of the old cutability factor, have we? Still there.
Here we go! Come on! Come on! Come on!
Hey, I'm the only one who hasn't aged.
30 years young. Radio 1.
The original lineup of Radio 1 DJs. They had about as much in common as Acabilk and Mick Jagger, yet together they were supposed to reflect the mood of the swinging 60s. On the world stage, pop music was combustible, radical, sexual, dangerous. By the time Radio 1 was about to go on air in September 1967, pop music had already been to the party of parties and was suffering a hangover from the summer of love. Yeah, we couldn't get no time. But if a sexual revolution was in the air, it had yet to reach the airwaves of the BBC.
And we'll have more for you later on.
Wake up easy, start the day right.
For the corporation's existing light program was still broadcasting to a generation untouched by the 60s. By replacing it with Radio 1, the BBC had to marry these two incompatible audiences. Illegal pirate radio stations were the catalyst for change. They'd gathered a great following among the young.
Purpose, we're gonna do the thing right here with the Emperor Rosko on Caroline South.
But an enemy in the government, who eventually sunk them.
10 seconds to go. Before
hours later, the BBC was ready to take over, and an ex-pirate DJ from Radio Caroline made a short journey to Broadcasting House.
Radio 2, Radio 1, go.
The voice of Radio 1. Just for fun.
Music.
Too much.
And good morning, everyone. Welcome to the exciting new sound of Radio 1.
Woke up one morning, half asleep.
The pirate, Tony Blackburn, may have been a rebel, he was not. At 24, this Tory voting doctor's son was very much the acceptable face of youth.
The thing about Tony was that he could be relied upon to deliver a very fast-moving show with wisecracks,
some of them silly schoolboy jokes, if you like. But he would appeal not only to the young audience, but from the records he was playing, but he would also appeal to perhaps a middle-aged commuter-type audience sitting in cars.
Next up was a pop star of the time. The time in question, 1955.
If I painted a picture of you, I'd
at 45, Jimmy Young's career at the helm of the big band sound was redirected into driving Radio 1 through the mornings, hopefully taking the old light program audiences with him.
pill every morning to get my chest started. And I forgot to take it this morning, so you might have a pull.
Exactly 9 o'clock here on Radio 1. Hi, Jim.
How are you, then?
Very well, thanks.
I think I've just broken the track record, actually, for...
Yeah. You have, have you?
1 minute and 35 seconds.
You sound all puffed out.
That's only because I'm puffed out.
I wasn't, let's be honest, everybody's first choice to be on Radio 1, because there was the question of whether I would fit into all this. And so I got a 3-month contract. It was as simple as that. And with the 3-month contract came a very succinct message. And the message was, you make a success of it in 3 months, or you're on your way.
The Mavericks and the Mischief Makers occupied the night shift and the weekends. Free radicals like John Peel and the bearded one they called the genius of radio, Kenny Everett.
He was a great... lively...
Hell in there.
Cheeky...
Tea, coffee, sugar, and gramophones.
Rebellious.
Today, the BBC. Tomorrow, ITV, if they love me.
Wonderful, genius sort of chap. And I like those sort of people. And impossible at times.
And now, from the sewage room, Salford, it's Radio 1 Club! Oh, dear. Let me press a button.
Don't worry, I'll do it for you.
The voice of Radio 1!
It's the Dave Cash Show!
DJs were limited in how many records they could play. The record industry and the Musicians' Union insisted that Radio 1 included generous amounts of live music. Inadvertently, this led to some historic recordings.
I was given a show called Monday Monday, which came from the Playhouse Theatre on the Embankment, and it had Ray McVeigh in the band of the day with Joe Fagan, I think, was the singer, and Patsy Jones was the singer. And they used to do cover versions, because there was no needle time, of A Whiter Shade of Pale and all this sort of thing, which was, you know, a bit iffy. And we used to have one guest. And the rule at the BBC was the smaller amount of numbers you could get, the better. And I went to the producer, Keith Bates, and I said, I've got a trio for you. He said, great, trio? Only three? I said, yeah, we'll book them. Jimi Hendrix came on at the Playhouse Theatre, and all these old women used to come in and do their knitting. And when he started playing with his teeth and all this kind of business, they just, oh.
Radio 1 hit the ground running. Within a month, it doubled the light program's audience. But one place where you would never hear Jimi Hendrix was on the Jimmy Young Show. While the veteran DJ may have been a Purple Haze man, it was his producer, the legendary Doreen Davies, who called the shots and determined the program's music policy.
I wouldn't ever put a piece of music on any program I ever did that people wouldn't want to go out and buy. And that was my policy.